Thank you very much. Any further announcements? Guess not. Okay, then. The prelude this morning, if we will prepare ourselves to worship, is Bagatelle number 11 on Dante from 11 Bagatelles by Beethoven. Would you all please rise for the call to worship? The greatness of God is beyond compare. God has directed the formation of the life we know. God has raised up the nations. Because of the many disturbing trends within her life, no.
We ask for God's guidance and blessings.
Would you please turn to 690 in the red hymnal?
Thank you.
seated. God of grace, for this time of worship, we are thankful. Draw near to us, O Lord, for we offer our thanksgiving. We are thankful to live in a country with freedom assured. Our forefathers recognized our hearts, our God-given rights of life, liberty, and worship. Accept the worship of our hearts and minds this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Please turn to 682 in the red hymnal for hymn of meditation. Please join me in the confession. God of grace, how wonderful to know your love for us. You have created all things yet care for us. In this time, we confess we often fail to live that life to which you call us. We often choose to go our own way. We have sinned against you and others. Forgive us, Lord, and empower us to be your faithful followers. Through Jesus we pray. Amen.
The scripture says, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Alleluia.
Alleluia. The epistle this morning is from 2 Corinthians. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, and I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or is heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. To keep me from being too elated, 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all that more gladly of my weakness, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whatever I am weak, then I am strong." Please rise for the Alleluia response. Gospel this morning is from Mark. Jesus came to his hometown and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James, Joseph, and Judith, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed and unbelief. Then he went among them about the villagers teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them the authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except the staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Whenever you enter the house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading.
That was meant to be with God as our Father, brothers all are we. Let me walk with my brother in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow to take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow, to take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. I have bruising on my shoulder from Cheryl's twisting my arm, but I was glad to sing that song. This morning I'd like to see that passage on 2 Corinthians 12. You might have noticed, I thought today might be a good time to make available copies of the Declaration of Independence. So there's some up front and there's some in the back. And if you have an old rusty copy, that was a way to renew your present copy. Our nation celebrates our independence today, commemorates the day the 13 original colonies joined together to declare their independence from Great Britain. In fact, the first time we're ever referred to as the United States of America was in the Declaration of Independence, which was accepted by the leadership of the 13 colonies on July 4th, 1776. On July 3rd, we were a collection of colonies discussing various items to be placed in this document or to be removed from this document. But on July 4th, the document received the necessary approval. The president of the Congress, John Hancock, signed it so that everybody could see his name, and we were the United States of America. July 4th, the birthday of our nation. And so I thought it's just really appropriate, this great old song, America the Beautiful, to begin the service with that. I'd like to quote a section that you could perhaps even follow me along. This section has always gotten to me ever since I first read it. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive to these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness, etc., etc. Of course, we all know the one sad element is that though Jefferson and others wanted to include a line against slavery, in order to create 13 colonies united against Great Britain, that particular section was deleted. We were to revisit it 85 years later in something called the Civil War. I hope that today, like every July 4th, we can take time to consider the virtues that make our nation strong and what obstacles that make us weak and what part we can play that in the next 245 years, this nation can be strengthened and become more than it is. In this past 2 years, we faced a lot of challenges. And nothing like what we saw prior to the Civil War or even during Reconstruction. We survived those things. It will be our challenge to ensure our continuance. with rationality and brotherhood. Oh yes, and sisterhood. There are well-meaning people who believe that pointing out weakness is their major task in life. There are those who are well-meaning people who believe that pointing out any weakness is unpatriotic. They are like the business owner who would not allow his wife or any of his employees to point out any of his shortcomings. And so he went to a formal company banquet where he was asked to say a few words. And so he stood before a group of men and women for about 30 minutes with a large piece of lettuce stuck firmly between his two front teeth. Everyone saw it, but no one pointed out any weakness, because that was not to be done. Sometimes the person who points out our weaknesses is our most valuable friend. The attempt to sort out the role, for example, of Black Americans in our history is for me a great step forward for us as a nation. Just the other day I was Googling opera singers, and just for fun, Black opera singers. And a whole slew of them appeared, who have sung all over the United States, all over Europe, in Milan, in the holy place of opera. And yet I hadn't heard of any of them except Marian Anderson and Leontine Price. It's just the way it is, I know. But it was just amazing. Well, today's lesson is from 2 Corinthians, and it deals with weaknesses, personal weakness. Nations have them, and we as individuals have them. It doesn't matter what image we present to the world. It doesn't matter how much money we have in our bank account. It doesn't matter what title we have, what degrees we have. We all have our weaknesses. And since we live in such a prosperous, image-driven society, those things are pretty well hidden up as best we can do it. You know, the only thing we put on Facebook is not our weaknesses, although there are those who inexplicably announce where they're going to take their vacation and how long they're going to be gone from their house, which is always amazing. Still, we do labor to put our best image out there. The last thing we want to have is anyone see our flaws. So St. Paul here gets all wrapped up in talking about his flaws. His thorn in the flesh. And this has created more discussion than almost anything else in Paul's writings. It seems like be most acceptable to think that it was the problem of epileptic seizures. And if so, he was in awfully good company. Two of the most powerful men who ever lived, Julius Caesar and Napoleon, were epileptics, and many great individuals have been. In Paul's day, there was no Dilantin or Keppra carbamazepine to control seizures. If that was his thorn, he was stuck with it. So Paul prayed that God would deliver him from his affliction. And I just have a short P.S. here. I don't know all the mystery of this, of intercessory prayer. I just believe it and do it. But every once in a while I hear somebody say, well, God didn't answer this prayer. Hello? He's not the bellman. And it may be best for us not to have that particular prayer answered. Although at the time we can't believe it. I think for Paul, he finally learned that he didn't like this, what was going on, and he repeatedly went to God. That's basic meaning when he said he went to God three times. But he got this answer, which just couldn't be too comfortable. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Right. You know, how that would hit somebody, to hear that in their minds as they think about their prayer out problem and perhaps epileptic seizures and what a mess that was. If you've ever, I remember walking into my final exam in my freshman year in college. It was in sociology. And I walked into the class, and all the desks had been moved out, and this poor guy, one of our classmates, was on the floor with four men on top of him, holding him down because he had had a seizure because of the stress generated by that final exam. You know, I can't imagine how that must have affected Paul. I mean, to me, Paul had this very strong self-image. I mean, he had been a Pharisee, he had been a leader in the Sanhedrin, he had been a persecutor of the church, yada, 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 this list, you know. And there he is, rolling on the floor with an epileptic seizure. It just must have torn him apart. But he said, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." In other words, God seemed to be saying to Paul, "Trust me, I will take care of you, and I can use your weakness to demonstrate my power." And you know, when it comes down to it, isn't that what it's all about? Aren't we here to strive to demonstrate God's goodness and grace? Not find greater levels of comfort for us? Weaknesses, as we all know, can become strengths for us. They can cause us to grow. And when we can grow beyond fear and self-centeredness and immaturity, we can reflect God's glory. God's glory may shine in our strengths, but it also shines in our weaknesses. When others see us grow in patience and wisdom and courage and faith through our heartaches, that's when God's glory shines such a convicting light into the hearts and minds of others around us. That's what causes them to say, "I see God in you. I want what you have." Some of us remember that great young man, Arthur Ashe. What a class act on the tennis court. Young African-American, took Wimbledon. I mean, just a glorious young man. At the height of his career, he contracted AIDS from a blood transfusion because of a mandatory heart surgery. Fellow athletes admired him for his skill and class on the court, and the world came to admire him even more for his courage in facing this tragic illness which led to his untimely death. I know, I couldn't believe it. It just didn't fit. In an interview, Ash commented, "If I asked why me about my troubles, I would have to ask why me about my blessings. Why am I winning Wimbledon? Why am I marrying a beautiful, gifted woman? Why having a beautiful, wonderful child?" And I thought, what an incredible perspective. Why me? Not so much, not about troubles, but also about blessings. Ash understood that God can use both our joys and our sorrows to grow us into people that can bring honor to his name. One person had said, "Our disappointments are his appointments." By God's grace, painful experiences or situations can help us grow. And of course, it's only human to pray for God to fix our troubles. Can't remember. I mean, I can't forget, I should say, how many times I was praying for God to help me through this mess that led to 30 days in ICU. That doesn't seem fair. But what do you do when God doesn't fix your problem? And that's when you pray that God will reveal himself through your problems, and you can hear in your head, My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. And when we give up our own strength and our dependence upon our own will and our own wisdom, that's the point we discover the true nature of God's character and the true faithfulness of God's promises. It just becomes a growing edge for our lives when we become fully aware of our life before God and how important it is to him. And God just says, give me your weaknesses and your strengths. Relax. Weaknesses can also become strengths if they make us more determined to give our best. Remember, our lives are not just about us as individuals. Again, if we believe in God as our creator, then we know that God made us for a greater purpose than our own choices and our own happiness and our own comfort. When people look at us, at our character and our choices and our actions, they see the power and truth and love and wisdom of God. Other people should feel some impact from our lives. So how we choose to respond to weakness matters. I've learned that we not only have the opportunity to demonstrate the presence of God through the transformation of our lives, but how we face our difficulties and how we face our problems. Bethany Noel Murray is an artist from Boston, Massachusetts. Better say that right, shouldn't I say? Boston, Massachusetts. Her paintings look like fantasies of magical forests filled with light and colors and strange shapes. Fans of her work describe it as looking at a beautiful landscape through a kaleidoscope. The secret to Murray's unique and beautiful paintings lies in the pain that she suffers. She has suffered from chronic migraines for over 20 years. In addition to the intense pain of the headaches, she also experiences sensitivity to life, light and sound, and distortions in her vision during a migraine. But rather than give up her art and hide, she turned her pain into beauty. She says, "My paintings have been proof to myself of what I experienced during attack. And despite the pain, I've made the choice to see the good, the weird, and the beautiful." God glows in our strengths. He shines in our weaknesses. And of course, weaknesses become really important if they can change our life course towards God. If we keep bumping our head up against a personal issue, maybe it's time we stop for a moment and think if there's another way it should be done. Sometimes our so-called weaknesses are simply warning signs to us that we are on the wrong road. Patrick Henry, I think, is a pretty good example of this. We remember him most because of his being a patriot and his oratory. But for most of his life, he was a miserable failure. He and his brother opened a store, but it failed. Next, his father-in-law set him up in farming. He was given 300 acres, a house, and lo and behold, 6 slaves. But somehow he did not think, he just didn't pull it together. And he didn't make it as a farmer either, even though everything was given to him on a silver platter. Of course, I know how that goes. Finally, on the advice of friends, Patrick turned to law. And at this point, we have all sorts of lawyer jokes, but I won't go there. Patrick turned to law. He was a natural persuader and a captivating orator. And as a lawyer, he was an instant success. He was exactly the voice that was needed to launch the colonies. Give me liberty or give me death. What a slogan. The perfect sentiment for the time. Though he shared a glaring and regrettable weakness with many of his ancestors, He was not a failure. He was simply in the wrong field for much of his life. Weaknesses draw us near to God, and in drawing us near to God, our strength becomes something that brings God honor. There's another great story about a young woman whose life shone through her weakness. Her name was Kristen Fursevich. She was a Canadian singer and songwriter who is known for her faith in God and her infectious joy. In June 2011, Kristen was diagnosed with cancer for the second time, and she was 27 years old. And this time, the doctor said it was inoperable. Kristen admits that she cried and prayed and pleaded, but she also made up her mind to face every day with joy. Everyone who met her was inspired by the joy they saw in her. One day during her prayer time, Kristen said to God, "I don't understand, but I trust you. Your ways and thoughts are higher than mine. Just speak to me, Father. Bring me comfort." And she flipped her Bible open, and there on the page she read were these words from Isaiah 55. "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace." On October 2013, at just 30 years of age, Kristen went to be with God. In her last conversation with her husband, Mike, she whispered a song of praise to him. It took all her strength to whisper those words to her husband, but it was a song of joy. She knew that God's grace was sufficient for her, and that God's grace was made perfect in her weakness. And so she faced her own weakness with joy, and as the scripture said, she went out in joy, and she was led forth in peace. God has the power, authority, and mercy to answer our every prayer and take away our every weakness. He could make our life as smooth and comfortable as a velvet blanket. Why doesn't he? Because our lives are meant to be a reflection of God's love and power, and a means by which God's love and power and restorative strength can be seen. His power is made perfect in our weakness. And may we have the faith to say with the Apostle Paul, obeying that wonderful bit of theology on Sue's bumper, "Quit sniveling." "Therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. And that is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties, for when I am weak, then I am strong." Tough words, but words of freedom. God bless them. Our song is number 283. For my soul,
to bear the dreadful curse for my soul. To God and to the Lamb.
Joys and concerns this morning.
Ed?
Yes, sir.
I have a confession.
That's good.
Well, it goes like this. 2.5 months ago, I started detailing my car for the first time in about 20 years. There was so much dirt, it took 2.5 months. But so many hours. Well, anyway. Well, I had to do what I had to do to bring on the rain. And so I continued on and I waxed the car and I gunked the engine and cleaned the engine twice. And then I left my roof window open and all the windows open. And I left it outside after I waxed it. And 3 days ago, we had rain. I mean, God really enjoys a good time. And, well, I just want to say it's all my fault. Please forgive me.
Moving on. Binky. Sue.
I have a joy. My daughter Katie and son-in-law Jenny's been here for about 2 weeks. We have a great trip to Montana, and today they leave to fly back to Alaska.
Ah.
And safe travels to
them. Amen. Sheila.
I need prayers. I'm going to have knee surgery. I've worn it out. I don't have a date yet, but I've seen the doc, the cutter.
Slice and dice time, right? Well, we will pray for you. Keep us informed.
Yeah, well, I'll give you a date.
Good. For you, not for me, please. Others, please. Arun.
Thank you for your continued prayers. Things seem to be better than, much better than they were about a month ago, but still preparing for any possible third wave. So, I appreciate your continued prayers. hardship and moving forward. It's a great testimony of her. She is American. She is, I think, from New York. And I'm going to have this available next week. Any money that comes in purchase of this will go towards help for COVID-19 in India. And thank you so much. Really appreciate your prayers.
Cool. Hi, Ann.
It's a joy to be back in church.
Yes. Joy to see you again.
I told you, when we could sing again, I'd be here.
Boy, that was one of those, yes, serendipitous occasions.
It's a joy.
Good to see you. Yeah, we have two Anns with us this morning. It's great to see you both, that's for sure.
And Pat.
And Pat. Yeah. Well, hi.
Hi. my daughter went down from Portland to Bend, Oregon, to drive with my granddaughter to Denver because my granddaughter's moving to Denver. And it was a long trip, and I was really concerned, but they got there safely and
cool. I have to share this bit of info. I got a phone call from one of my favorite nieces yesterday. She is just retired from about 35 years of service in the system over in California, and she's a computer specialist. And she phoned to say she would like to see me in Pueblo, Colorado on September 25th because she's getting married. She's been single all of her life. Just her and three cats. She'll find out that was probably, no. But she is just overjoyed, and I am for her. She is such a delightful person. But, okie doke, we should pray. Dear God, thank you for your constant mercy. Thank you that you can transform our lives. That you can turn our weaknesses into strengths, magnify our strengths into your joys, use us in so many different ways that we can't even measure in bringing you honor and glory. Thank you for using us and for blessing us and for strengthening us. And may we always look for that new day in which we can bring honor to you. We pray for Gina as she goes into surgery. We pray for your healing grace for her. We pray for safe travels for Sue's family back to Alaska. We pray for Sheila with her upcoming knee surgery. We pray for India and its thankfully the downturn of the COVID. Pray that there will not be a third wave, and pray that the relief will come for the people and churches of this nation. Thankful for Grace and her good news. Thankful that Sarah and Dawn have had a safe trip, and continue to bless them both. Guide our country, this place of our upbringing, and we ask for wisdom, how we can think about things and bring you honor and establish more strongly our union and concern for one another. We pray for our nation that it will not become divided,
but that the divisions present can be mended by your grace. We do pray, as the songwriter said, that all will come to embrace Jesus and through him work out all that needs to be worked out. We pray for our brethren throughout this world, especially those enduring persecution and opposition. May they have strength and encouragement. And now, God, we pray together that prayer Jesus taught us. And we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Our hymn of communion is number 30. Come to this time to remember our Lord, and we are thankful for this opportunity. Remember that night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, This is my body given for you. Take and eat.
as often as you used to do this in remembrance of me. And at the end of the meal, he took a cup and he said, this cup is the cup of my blood shed for the remission of sins. Drink you all of it. May we pray. God of grace, thank you always for this visual reminder, this physical reminder of our Lord and his gifts to us. We pray your blessing upon this bread for strength for our spiritual selves, for your blessing upon this cup for renewed cleansing and blessing of his death. Guide us each one as we partake. May we do so in a way that is pleasing to you, glorifies you. Thank you for your mercy. Through Christ we do pray. Amen. The communion is our Lord's table, so all that are here believing in Jesus, please feel free to partake. May our God richly bless us as we partake of this bread of life. Let us partake of the cup of salvation. Our song for completing the service is number 389 in the Red Book. You may stand. And we have some fresh cookies from various bakers, of course, that are ready to be served. So join in the fellowship. 389. Gracious God, we pray that in this week your grace will ever be so real to us, and that your Spirit will strengthen us and encourage us as we live out our lives, and that the love of Jesus Christ will ever inspire us and grant us the impetus to keep moving forward in our lives. Grant us now these things and your strength. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.